हरि ओम। We'll start with the invocation prayers. Hari Om.
सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावतीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। गीता ध्यानं। ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्ब त्वामनुसन्धदामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी। नमोऽस्तु ते व्यास विशालबुद्धे पुल्लारविन्दायत पत्रनेत्रा येन त्वया भारततैल्यपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयप्रदीपः प्रपन्न पारिजाताय स्तोत्रवैत्रीकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। सर्वोपनिषदो गावो दोक्ता गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्सस्सुधीर्भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतं महत्। वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं। भीष्मद्रोणतटा जयद्रथजला गान्धारनीलोत्पला शल्यग्राहवती कृपेण वहनी कर्णेन वेलाकुला अश्वत्थाम विकर्ण घोर मकरा दुर्योधनावर्तिनी सोतीर्णा खलु पाण्डवैरननी कैवर्तक केशवः। पाराशद्य वचः सरोजममलं गीतार्थगन्तोत्कटं नानाख्यानकेसरं हरिकथा सं बोधनाभूदितम्। लोके सज्जन षट्परैरहरः पीपीयमानं मुदा भूयात् भारत पङ्कजं कलिमल प्रध्वंसिन श्रेयसे। मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घयति गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवम्। यं ब्रह्मा वरुणीन्द्र रुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदै साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषते गायन्ति यं सामगाः। ध्यानावस्थित तद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनो यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरा सुरगणा देवाय तस्मै नमः। देवाय तस्मै नमः। शिवाय तस्मै नमः।
हरि ओम। गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, गुड आफ्टरनून एंड वेरी हैप्पी न्यू ईयर। आवर फर्स्ट सत्संग इन दिस न्यू कैलेंडर ईयर। थैंक यू फॉर bearing with the break in between. It was definitely worth it for me and Sarika, who accompanied me. And maybe sometime we can share some, you know, clippings with you on the trek that we took. So today we are starting with chapter 6, which is Dhyana Yoga, the yoga of meditation. And before we dive into, the meditation, all about meditation, let's do a quick recap, especially because we have had a little bit of a break. So we saw that the Bhagavad Gita brings to us the vast knowledge that is covered in the Vedas, and it brings this to us in a very simple and uplifting manner. Bhagavan Sri Krishna, has made sure that not only we all understand it easily, but we can also relate it to our lives, and it is relevant for all times. The Bhagavad Gita has three sections. It's divided into three sections, or the Kandatrayam. Section 1 is chapter 1 to 6, and we are going to start with chapter 6 today. And this section, along with describing karma, it gives clarity on the nature of the self, the Atman, which is the Atma Swarupa. Section 2 is chapter 7 to 12, and the section 2, even as it gives details of upasana or devotion, it gives clarity on the nature of Bhagavan, nature of God or Ishvara, which is the Bhagavat Swarupa or the Ishvara Swarupa. And section 3 is chapter 13 to 18. Even as it gives details on jnana, it provides clarity on the nature of non-duality. Some say this non-duality is Advaita, and which is that both Bhagavan and all of his creation are of one nature. Some say that it is of similar nature. Bhagavan and all of his creation are of similar nature, which is Vishishta Advaita. And what have we covered till now? Chapter 1 is the depiction of Arjuna's delusion and sorrow, which is Arjuna Vishada Yoga, of his Shoka and Moha, sorrow and delusion. Chapter 2 is Sankhya Yoga, or the Yoga of Knowledge, the knowledge of the self, Atma Vidya, and the knowledge of performance of one's duty, which is Swadharma Vidya. Chapter 2 is also a summary of the Bhagavad Gita in prospect, where Bhagavan touches upon everything that he is going to cover from chapter 3 to 18. In brief, chapter 3 we saw is Karma Yoga, which deals with karma in more detail, performing action with the right attitude. And Bhagavan says Karma Yoga is the foundation to a spiritual life. Chapter 4 we saw is the Karma Sannyasa Yoga, which deals with the knowledge of actions that we perform, and that knowledge which then helps us view the very same action in different light. Essentially, we are able to, with that knowledge, we are able to let go of the sense of doership by seeing action in inaction and inaction in action. Chapter 5 we saw is Karma Sannyasa Yoga. Chapter 4 was Jnana Karma Sannyasa Yoga, the knowledge through which we get away from the sense of doership. And chapter 5 is Karma Sannyasa Yoga, the yoga of true renunciation, which then teaches us the giving up of our anxieties, which come from the mental preoccupation, to the fruits of their action, the results of the action. So this is what we have covered till now. And along with each chapter, we also listed out sadhana, specific learning, specific practice that we should indulge in, which will then help us derive the true benefit from each of these chapters. And the learnings and practice or sadhana from these chapters were, chapter one, which is Arjuna Vishada Yoga, we said, Bhagavan taught us, watch closely for Shoka and Moha. And at the first sight of Shoka and Moha, remove them, eliminate them. Chapter two, maintain equipoise in extremities. There are extremities in life, maintain equipoise among them. Samatvam Yoga Uchyate. Chapter three was Samachara. Bhagavan taught us how to perform every action with utmost devotion, utmost dedication, and perfection. Chapter 4, Karmanya Karmanya Paschet. Not being the doer while doing the action. Seeing inaction in action. Practice this. And chapter 5 was Padma Patram Ivam Vasa. Just like a lotus petal which is untouched by the water that is on it, even though the water is in contact, but the petal itself is untouched. Similarly, be in contact with the world and the worldly experiences, but remain untouched by them. Chapter 6, or Dhyana Yoga, the yoga of meditation, is what we are going to start now. And a mind and intellect that has been fully developed through the practice, through following the teachings of Bhagavan up until now, from chapter 1 to 5, that mind and intellect is now better equipped for what? For self-contemplation, for self-unfoldment, and for self-realization. And how this is done through the practice of this famous technique of meditation is the theme of the 6th chapter. Establishing oneself in meditation and absorption. And through that, getting more and more deeper, absorbing the knowledge that we have gained and getting more deeper into devotion, nididhyasana and samadhi. This is what we are going to start today. So let us start with the first verse. Shri Bhagavan Vacha.
Om Paramatmane Namaha.
Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha.
Atashashtodhyayaha.
अथ षष्ठोऽध्यायः
ध्यानयोगः
ध्यानयोगः
श्रीभगवानुवाच
श्रीभगवानुवाच
अनाश्रितकर्मफलम्
अनाश्रितकर्मफलम्
कार्यं कर्म करोति यः
कार्यं कर्म करोति यः तसन्यासी च योगी च
न निरग्निर्न चाक्रियः
न निरग्निर्न चाक्रियः
श्रीभगवानुवाच अनाश्रितकर्मफलं कार्यं कर्म करोति यः ससन्यासी च योगी च
So Bhagavan is beginning his teachings on Dhyana Yoga, and we will come to the name of the chapter, which is Atma Samyama Yoga, in a little bit. And what does he do in the beginning? How does he begin? Does he start with teaching us what is Atma Samyama, what is Dhyana, what is meditation? No, he once again glorifies Karma Yoga. Look at the beauty of this. He is beginning teaching on meditation, but he is glorifying Karma Yoga. Ya karoti, one who performs what? Karyam karma, duties that ought to be performed. The bounden duties. We saw about that earlier. Anashritaha karma phalam, not focusing on the fruits of the action. Anashritaha, not focusing on karma phala, which is the result of the action. Usually, success in action is glorified. And not only that, self-glorification is attached to success in action. That self-glorification could be by oneself or could be by people who are associated with it. One who performs obligatory duties, not focusing on the fruits, not focusing on this glorification or self-glorification or the result. Bhagavan says, sannyasi cha yogi. Is a sannyasi and a yogi. even though this person is a karma yogi, since the person performs the same karma as karma yoga in the prescribed manner. What is the prescribed manner? Ishvara arpana buddhi, dedicating whatever we do to the Lord, and prasada buddhi, receiving whatever we get as benevolence of the Lord. Such a person is a sannyasi. And then Bhagavan continues to say, chana niragnir na chakriyaha. And this person is not without fire, nor is he without action. Meaning, the person performs all action. This person is busy all the time, but the person performs the same action, sacrificing it as a means of sacrifice, the yajna spirit that we have seen earlier, that Bhagavan has taught to us earlier. Performs all action with the spirit of yajna, with the spirit of sacrifice. Sacrificing what? Renouncing what? Both the sense of doership, I am doing, the agency. I am the one who is acting. That agency, renouncing it, and the anxiety to the result or the fruits of action. Sometimes, you know, when we are at work in office, and I have experienced this so many times in my life, you know, the pace of work is at its pinnacle. Everything is a whirl. You know, you get into the office and it is just one big whirl of action. And if we are talking, we are discussing, we are typing, we are coding, we are performing all kinds of actions. But if we are doing this with that Ishvara Arpana Buddhi and with that Prasada Buddhi, devoting everything to that higher cause, not hankering for the result, then we are performing Karma Yoga. Oftentimes you don't even realize, suddenly, you know, you get a call from home or somebody says, hey, are you not going home? You look outside, it's dark. You thought, I just came to the office 5 minutes ago and it's already dark. So this used to, and actually I used to, when people used to talk about meditation, we used to also have meditation and yoga sessions in the office sometimes, you know. And I used to ask, you know, what is meditation? You know, the fact that you didn't even realize that 10 hours have passed, is that meditation? Or sitting, closing your eyes and sitting in an asana for 15 minutes, half an hour is meditation? Bhagavan says here in this verse that this kind of action, deep action, which you get engrossed in, devoting it to the higher cause and not bothering and not hankering for the result, is also a person who does this is also a sannyasi. And then Bhagavan goes on to explain in verse 2.
Yam sannyasamiti prahuhu.
Yam sannyasamiti prahuhu.
Yogam tam viddhi pandava.
Yogam tam viddhi pandava.
Nahya sannyasta sankalpaha.
Nahya sannyasta sankalpaha.
Yogi bhavati kashchana.
Yogi bhavati kashchana.
Yam sannyasamiti prahuhu. Yogam tam viddhi pandava. Nahya sannyasta sankalpaha. Yogi bhavati kashchana.
Bhagavan says, O Pandava. He addresses Arjuna as Pandava. O Pandava, viddhi, please know. Please know what? What is glorified as sannyasamiti? Prahuhu means glorified as. What is glorified? That sannyasa. That is also karma yoga. That person is also doing karma yoga. Yogam here refers to karma yoga. And then Bhagavan says, kashchana, anyone who is asanyasta, not renouncing. Asanyasta means holding on to, not renouncing. Not renouncing what? And Bhagavan actually uses the word he, which is surely not renouncing. Sankalpaha. Sankalpaha means determined will, the want with which you plan for something. You plan action to get something. That sankalpa. That person does not become a yogi. Anyone who has not renounced sankalpa, that person surely does not become a yogi. Having sankalpa or determined will or wants leads to what? Leads to hankering for the result. So that defeats the purpose completely. Bhagavan says that such a person who does not renounce does not become a yogi. And then he continues in verse 3.
Arurukshor munir yogam.
Arurukshor munir yogam.
Karma karana muchyate.
Karma karana muchyate.
Yogarudasya tasyaiva.
Yogarudasya tasyaiva.
Shamakarana muchyate.
Shamakarana muchyate.
Arurukshor munir yogam. Karma karana muchyate. Yogarudasya tasyaiva. Shamakarana muchyate.
So Bhagavan says, for a muni, a sage, a karma yogi, the person is already a muni, okay? For a muni who wishes to what? Aru Ruksho, who wishes to climb what? Yogam. For that person, karma karana muchyate, action is said to be the means. Uchyate means said, is said to be. Action is the means. For the person who is wishing to climb the pedestal of yoga, action is said to be the means. And for the same yogi, for example, like I use the example of being engrossed in work, not knowing the passage of time. For that person, action is said to be the means. For that same person, once that person has climbed, once that person is established in yoga, yoga rudasya means established in yoga, of that person, tasya iva, what is the means? Shamaha. Shamaha means quietitude. Shamaha karana muchyate. Shamaha is said to be the means. Quietitude is said to be the means. The first couple of times I rode a horse, when I was in the army, I learned horse riding. You know, and once you would get off the horse, people who did not choose or opt for horse riding, you know, they would ask, how was it? And the first couple of times my response was, I don't know what I was doing. It was the horse which was driving me. You know, I have no idea what was going on. It was not like to the person who is watching, you're thinking that, you know, you are riding the horse, but it's actually the horse that is dragging you. To bring the steed under control, there is a period when you have to have one leg on the stirrup. Stirrup is that thing where you can put your leg in. You know, it's hanging on the side of a horse. One leg on the stirrup. And you have to hang on to the saddle, leave the ground, hang on to the saddle. Like in Hindi, they say latakna. You know? And then you swing your other leg over the horse and take it to the other side and sit, mount on the back of the horse. And then secure the other leg into the other stirrup also. So for a period of time, you're neither on the ground nor on the horse. And the horse is trotting. Thank God it's not galloping, because if it's galloping, you'll probably get thrown off. Most of the time, a sensible, well-trained horse will be trotting. And you're neither on the ground nor on the horse, right? On both places. And then once you are in a comfortable seated position, mounted on the horse with the reins in your hand, then you are able to control, and then the horse is under your will and you are riding the horse and you are driving the horse, not the other way around. But before that, like I said, a brief time passes through, it must pass through, where you are neither on the ground nor on the horse. Similarly, in the beginning, we are merely performing karma. And that karma is desire-driven, it is ego-driven. We are always looking for the result and we are always thinking that I am performing that action. When a person who is performing action in this manner, thinking that I am performing, wanting and expecting the result of that action, that person wants to go beyond this. See, this person who is on the horse, on the steed, with one leg on the stirrup, he wants to gain control. He wants to sit down, mount the horse and gain control. Similarly, this person who is doing karma with ego, with desire, wants to get out of that ego, wants to get out of that desire. The person wants to do it. And to bring in control what? Her own mind, her own intellect. And then ride over it. This mind, intellect, steed or horse, ride over that. That person is called Aru Ruksha. First word in this verse, Aru Ruksho. This person who desires to let go of ego, let go of hankering and control the mind intellect is called Aru Ruksha. She then takes up the same work as before, but there is a difference. The difference is the same karma, the same work with Ishvara Arpana Buddhi and Prasada Buddhi. Neither desire prompted nor ego driven. And a person who has already mounted the steed of the mind, one who has ascended onto the platform of perfection in yoga. Ascended, climbed means Arudha. Arudha means climbed. That yogi, that person is called a Yoga Rudha. So Aruruksha is one who desires, and after achievement that Aruruksha becomes Yoga Rudha. To this Yoga Rudra, what is the means? Quietitude, Samaha. That is the means of gaining what? Even more, a higher degree of perfection and self-growth. Towards self-actualization, self-realization. Beautiful verse by Bhagavan, you know, where he is talking about how we start off just doing action, but with all the desire and thinking we are doing it. Then we want to let go of that connect, that let go of that ego and the desire. We wish to do it. And once we wish to do it, we become the Aru Rukshaha. And that Aru Rukshaha, once attains that perfection, is called Yoga Rudra. And then Bhagavan says, what? How do you know a person is a Yoga Rudra? What is the litmus test? That he covers in the next verse.
Yada hinindriyarteshu.
Yada hinindriyarteshu
na karmasvanu sajjate
na karmasvanu sajjate
sarva sankalpa sanyasi
sarva sankalpa sanyasi
yogarudhastadochyate
yada
hinindriyarteshu na karmasvanu sajjate sarva sankalpa sanyasi yogarudhastadochyate
yogarudhastadochyate. Then this person is called a yogarudha. When? So yogarudha is one who has attained the acme of yoga, the pinnacle of yoga, pinnacle of human perfection, that zenith. When that pinnacle of human perfection is within her, within him, then that person is a Yoga Rudra. And Bhagavan gives three symptoms or characteristics of this person, of being established in yoga. And Bhagavan says, yada hi, surely, when, surely, what? Number one, na indriyarteshu. When surely not in sense objects. What does it mean? Indriya are senses, artha are objects. Indriyartheshu means not in, na indriyartheshu means not in the sense objects. For the eyes, the objects are the form and the color, which is rupa. For the ears, the objects are sound, shabda. For the nose, the object is smell, gandha. For the tongue, the object is taste, rasa. And for the skin, the objects are experienced through touch, which is sparsha. And sense pleasures are a combination of all of them. Permutation combination of all of these. And Bhagavan says, when a person is not in the sense objects, not dwelling in rupa, shabda, gandha, rasa, sparsha. When you are not dwelling in them, na indriyartheshu, that is number one. Number two, na कर्मस्वनुषज्जते, अनुषज्जते कर्म, नॉट अटैच्ड टू एक्शंस. षज्जते मीन्स अटैच्ड, अनुषज्जते मीन्स स्ट्रॉन्गली अटैच्ड, न अनुषज्जते मीन्स नॉट अटैच्ड टू व्हाट, टू द चार्म, द मैग्नेटिक पुल ऑफ एक्शंस ऑफ द आउटर वर्ल्ड. एंड द थर्ड कैरेक्टरिस्टिक और ट्रेट दैट भगवान डिस्क्राइब्स फॉर दिस योग रूढ़ा इज सर्व संकल्प सन्यासी, having renounced all sankalpa. Sankalpa, like we just covered, is what? Determined will. Determined because that will then determines the action, which will then ensure that you get what you want. And this sankalpa comes from imagination. Samyukt iti kalpana, attached to the imagination. And this sannyasi is one who has renounced this attachment, who has renounced this kalpana. Because the person realizes that such a sankalpa, such a kalpana would be tantamount to imagining joy where there is no happiness. Remember, even in the first satsang, we talked about happiness, which is deeper inside your core, which is longer, permanent. Joy is something which is temporary. I can have an ice cream, relish it, but it goes away after some time. Even the joy of, you know, climbing the Himalayas goes away after some time, although it lingers on for much, much longer. But even that goes away after some time. So imagining happiness where there is joy, renunciating that. So basically, what has this person done? This person has dropped dependency upon imaginary happiness. This person has dropped dependency upon sensory hankerings. And where do sensory hankerings come from? They come from that imagination. And this person has dropped dependency upon planning actions in order to achieve the above two. The happy imaginary happiness and the sensory hankerings. In order to get them, you plan action. And that planning comes from what? Comes from that hankering. So this person has dropped all three of them. And then Bhagavan says, sarva, all, not just one of them, not just for a period of time, all of them, giving up all the hallucinations, all the inclinations, all the wants. And he says, to repeat, yadahi, when surely a person has done all of these three. Yoga rudasya tadochyate. Tadochyate, tada, then, uchyate, is said to be a yoga rudha, one who is established in yoga. So in these four verses, Bhagavan Sri Krishna has taught us three things. Number one, do not give up karma yoga in a hurry. So even though he's starting teaching on dhyana yoga, he's saying do not give up karma yoga. Karma yoga is glorifying karma yoga. Because what is the biggest risk of getting into dhyana? The biggest risk of getting into dhyana is being pretentious. That is why Bhagavan is cautioning, do not give up karma yoga. Being pretentious and taking shortcuts will not lead to success in dhyana. Then Bhagavan says the second thing, he says, continue to perform karma yoga. Till when? Till you climb the ladder of yoga to the pinnacle, to the top. Till you become a yoga rudha. And he gives, who is a yoga rudha? He describes. Till then you have to continue karma yoga. And then he says, how do we know that I have become established, or you know, my guru has become established, or anyone has become established? How do I know? That person who does not have imaginations, is not lingering on to imaginary happiness, that person who does not have inclinations, and that person who does not have wants. Imaginary happiness, sensory hankerings, and planning actions to achieve these two. So these are the three teachings that he has given us. Sri Ramakrishna said, the brilliant presence of Ishvara. Remember that story about the Alvars? The fourth Alvar saw the brilliance of Bhagavan under the light. that brilliant presence of Ishvara, quote unquote, the brilliant, quote, brilliant presence of Ishvara cannot be perceived in a mental firmament that is directed by a gale of desires or by the gale of desires, unquote. And where do these gale of desires originate from? Imaginations, inclinations, wants. Now Bhagavan teaches what a sadhaka, who is that seeker, the Arurukshana, that seeker, what that sadhaka should do to become a yogaru. So Bhagavan has told you that, you know, the sadhaka or the Aruruksha, that same Aruruksha becomes the Yogaruda. What should that person do? We'll go to verse 5.
Uddharetatmanatmanam.
Naatmanam avasadayet.
Atmaivahyatmano bandhu. Atmaivaripuratmanah. Atmaivahyatmano bandhu. Atmaivaripuratmanah.
Atmaivaripuratmanah.
Uddharidatmanatmanam. Natmanamavasadayet. Atmaivahyatmanobandhu. Atmaivaripuratmanah.
Uddharetatmanatmanam. Lift yourself by yourself. Uddharet is lift. Atmana, by yourself. What? Atmanam, yourself. Lift yourself by yourself. Engage yourself in positive pursuit. Cultivate spiritual values and lift yourself with your own mind and intellect that has been fortified by spiritual strength. And Bhagavan has taught us earlier, where does this come from? It comes from Viveka, Vairagya, Shama, Dama, Uparama, Titiksha, Shraddha, Sadhana, Mumushuktva, which is the Sadhana Chatushtayam. We must remember that. Among the first steps in the spiritual path. Through that, and through the Vyavasayatmika Buddhi, the determined pursuit of that path, through these two, lift yourself by yourself. And then Bhagavan says, Na Atmanam Avasadayet. Do not lower yourself by yourself. Avasadayet is the opposite of lifting, dropping, drowning, lowering. That is Avasadayet. Do not lower yourself by wrong pursuits, especially after understanding the right path to progress. I mean, anything, if you want to lose weight, and the right part to losing weight is exercise. We have understood it, we know it, we have experienced the benefit of it, and then we don't do exercise. It's the wrong path. So anything that we do, and in the spiritual progress, in the path of spiritual progress, it is all the more important. Avasadayet also means becoming depressed or demotivated, especially in the face of challenges or in the face of failures. You know, especially in these COVID times and all that, we hear so much about people getting demotivated or depressed, right? That's also avasadayet. Gurudev Swami Chinmayananda ji said, and I quote, fall if you wish or if you have to, but like a rubber ball that bounces back, not like an iron ball, because that iron ball will remain on the ground. If you have to, if circumstances have put you in a situation that you are falling, bounce back. Why? Atmaiva hyatmano bandhu. You alone. Atma iva. You alone. Iva means alone. Surely are friend of yourself. Who can be of assistance to you but yourself? Can your mother eat when you are hungry? She can bring food to you, but if she eats, will your hunger go away? In the mountains, you know, my trek guide was of immense help to me. I mean, he was doing seva, like, you know, I was so, Sarika was witnessing it. It was extremely helpful. Okay, from carrying my pack to, you know, to sometimes to even putting my, what is that called, which prevents the snow from going into your boots. Okay, he would put it for me, right? To pitching my tent, everything, lot of things. You know, he used to do a lot of things for me. But then at night at 2 a.m., it's minus 25 degrees outside, you're in your sleeping bag, and I have to, you know, answer nature's call. Okay, minus 25 in the sleeping bag inside the tent, 3-4 layers are out. You know, to go out in that temperature, you need those 4 layers. So can I say, avatar, yaar jara please, mere liye kar do. Can I do that? I have to get up, I have to wear those layers one after the other, and then I have to go out, and then I have to come back, remove those layers, get back into my sleeping bag. There is no shortcut. I have to do it. I have to lift myself by myself to do it. And guess what? To climb that peak also, Avatar has done it so many times. After leaving us in the base camp, again, he goes with the next group the next day. Probably in a season, he does it every third day he is in the peak. That's life for him. So he has done it so many times, but can he do it for me? I have to do it for myself. Nobody else can come and do it for me. So Bhagavan says, lift yourself by yourself. Uddharet atmanam atmanam. And if you don't do it, then what? Atma iva ripuratmanaha. Atma iva, you alone are what? Ripuhu. Ripuhu means enemy of yourself. So if you don't do that, you alone are your own enemy. And what sort of a person is a friend or an enemy of oneself? How do I know whether I am a friend of myself or an enemy of myself? That Bhagavan says in the next verse.
Bandhuratmatmanastasya.
Yenatmaivatmanajitaha.
Anatmanastu shatrutve. Vartetatmaiva shatruvat. Panduratmatmanastasya. Yenatmaivatmanajitaha. Anatmanastu shatrutve. Vartetatmaiva shatruvat.
Yena atmaiva atma jitaha. That's how it is broken up. Yena, by whom? Atmaiva, the self. In this case, what is this atma self? The body, mind, intellects. Iva alone, atmana, by the self, jitaha, is conquered. And tasya, of that self, atma, bandhu, atma, of that self, the self is a friend. For that person who has conquered his body, mind and intellect, by himself alone, the self is his friend. And anatmanastu shatrutve. Vartetatmaiva shatrutvat. But for that person who has not conquered the body, mind, intellect by himself alone, the self works against him just like an enemy. Varteta. Varteta means remains, behaves like. Like what? Shatrutvat. Shatruvat, like an enemy. As if in lieu shatrutve, in lieu of an enemy. Normally, enemy is what? Outside, somebody who's arming us. We'll come, Bhagavan talks about all of that also later. We'll come to that in verse 9. Okay, there may be somebody outside who's arming us, but like that outside external force, this self is harming yourself. Inside each one of us, there are two personalities. The higher divine self and the lower satanic self. What separates the virtuous person from the evil person? The person who is making positive progress, thereby also helping others and herself also. What separates such a person from another person who is sliding down the negative alley, harming others, causing trouble to others, causing misery to others and to himself also? We all have heard about this famous Cherokee legend. I'm sure each one of us has heard, but it's worth repeating here. An old Cherokee, he's teaching his grandson about life. And he says, son, there is this fight that is going on inside me. And it's a terrible fight. And it is between two wolves. One of those wolves is evil. Anger, envy, greed, arrogance, self-pity, sorrow, evil wolf. And the other wolf is a good wolf. Peace, love, hope, humility, serenity, happiness. And he says, son, the same fight is going on inside you also. If not, you don't feel it now, you'll feel it sometime. And the same fight is going on inside everyone. The child is listening, wide-eyed. And as the grandpa pauses, the child asks, grandpa, which wolf will win? And the grandfather says, simply, the one you feed, my son. Raise yourself by yourself. My guru Swami Advayananda ji, he relates a story, you know, of his personal experience. When he went to Tapovan, Tapovan is another trek, beautiful trek that one must do. Like most saints, you know, sannyasis, you know, they just walk with their loin cloth and, you know, maybe a small, they take diksha wherever they go. They don't have possessions. So similarly, he also went to Tapovan, you know, climbed up. It's a tough, very difficult. It's one of the difficult treks. The Tapovan, and he went without any possession, no tent, no cooking, no avatar to help and, you know, put on your the anklets. Okay, nobody there. And then there is another Swami who lives in Tapovan, you know, most of, except for maybe a month or so. I have been to Tapovan, I've met, I've actually stayed with that Swamiji. It's called Mauni Baba. Mauni Baba lives in Tapovan at that altitude of 16,000 feet. Through winter, through summer, alone, all by, there's nobody else, huh? Only he. When these trekkers go there, when the season is good, that time there are people to see. When they are not there, there is nobody. And because he lives there all alone, he actually finds it very difficult to talk. He talks, but it is very difficult to understand him because he has hardly ever spoken to anybody. Only when these 3, 4, 5 months in a year when people are going there, there is some conversation. So he's called Mauni Baba. He doesn't speak. And when he speaks, because he's not used to speaking, you know, its words don't come out very easily from him. So a lot of the conversation he does through, say, sign. He has to make sign. So it's very interesting to watch him and to learn from him. So Swamiji goes to Mauni Baba and he says, Babaji, you need help me with accommodation and bhiksha. And Mauni Baba has 3-4 bunkers, you know, like army bunkers in the hill. These are dug rooms inside the mountaintop. So he has those 3-4 bunkers out there. And Swamiji is requesting Mauni Baba. And Mauni Baba says, who are you? So Swamiji says, Babaji, I am the disciple of Swami Chinmayananda. Now, Tapovan is named after Swami Tapovan Maharaj. Swami Chinmayananda is a disciple of Swami Tapovan Maharaj. And Tapovan Maharaj used to live in Tapovan. And Swami Chinmayananda ji was a student, lived in Tapovan with him, did seva and learned from him. So Swamiji Advayananda ji is thinking, what I, you know, this is the biggest credit I can have. I'm Swami Chinmayananda ji's direct disciple. And he says, I'm Swami Chinmayananda ji's disciple. thinking that this would be a great qualification. He was stunned by Babaji's response. He said, I did not ask you about your guru's glories, to sing your glories of your guru. Who are you? So after a brief pause, thinking and, you know, absorbing that bullet from Babaji, Swamiji said, I am a friend of myself. I am my friend. And I hope to make you my friend too. So each one of us has to master ourselves. And how do we master ourselves? You know, nowadays there are courses on self-mastery. How do you master yourself? The coach of self-mastery can become your friend, but that's not going to help. By becoming your own friend. And how does conquering oneself, how does it help? That Bhagwan now talks about in the next verse, in the seventh verse.
Jitatmana
prashantasya
paramatma samahitah shitoshna sukha dukkeshu
tathamanapamanayoho
Chitatmana prashantasya paramatma samahitah shitoshna sukha dukkeshu tathamanapamanayoho
shitoshna sukha dukkeshu tathamanapamanayoho shita cold. I know what cold is after living 3 weeks there in winter. Unbelievable cold. It's practically 24 hours of the day, it is minus temperature. Ushna, heat. Sukha, pleasure. Dukha, pain. Mana, honor. Apamana, dishonor. These are all there in the world, in the samsara. And they are offered to each one of us free of cost. All of us love free things, right? They are offered free. Like they say, free, you know, in the advertisement. Offered free of cost. All of these are varied experiences at the body, mind, intellect level. But for that person who has conquered the body, mind, intellect, by lifting herself by herself, has conquered that body, mind, intellect, that person, the jitatma of the self-controlled, jitatma means self-controlled, that person, the prasantasya, prasantasya means of the peaceful, of the self-controlled, of the peaceful. Meaning one who has no delusion of getting permanent happiness from the outside world. One who is not hankering for sensory experiences. One who is not initiating action to attain both of these. For such a person, paramatma samahitaha. Paramatma, the supreme self, the higher self. That paramatma samahitaha becomes balanced. The process for this has been very well explained by Bhagavan Sri Krishna. He says karma yoga, start with karma yoga, turn karma into karma yoga. How is that done? Ishwara arpana buddhi, prasada buddhi. When you keep doing that, you become a yogaruda. Do it till you become a yogaruda. Don't stop. And what is a yogaruda? Established in yoga. And that will then take you to become a jitatma. Who is a jitatma? A person whose lower self is controlled. And then it takes you to paramatma samahitaha, where the higher self is balanced. Ishwararpana buddhi, prasada buddhi, establishing in yoga, controlling the lower self, and the higher self gets balanced. So this Arabian horse, since today is the day of horses, you know, the Arabian horse is a very versatile animal. It dominates the discipline of endurance riding. Endurance riding is one of the toughest sports. And the Arabian horse dominates the sport of endurance riding. Also, you would have seen in Republic Day and all that, the president's bodyguard. You know, nowadays there are lots of Indian breeds also that are coming up, that are being trained very well. But back then, it was the Arabian horse which was dominating the president's bodyguard also. So because of the nature of service that these horses do, they must be trained extremely well and they must have unquestioning obedience to their masters. So early in their training, they are taught how to respond instantly to their master's command. And then once they are taught, they are given a test to see how they perform under stress, under duress, under pressure. So what happens is they are kept in an enclosure for a number of hours, and horses, number of hours, meaning maybe even 2, 3, 4 days without a drop of water, no water. And when there is no water, obviously no food also, because food has water in it. And right outside the gate of the enclosure, there is water available. So the horses can smell the water. It's there, but they cannot go. They're all locked inside. And then after this long period of time, the gate is opened and the horses make a beeline. They gallop towards the water. Just before they reach the water, the master blows a whistle. Now, some of these horses, because they are so thirsty, they don't pay heed. They don't care for the master's whistle. They go and drink the water. And some horses stop right there, turn back and gallop back to their master. These are the ones that have climbed the ladder of discipline, of yoga. And they are the ones that qualify for these important jobs that I described earlier. The others do not. The others probably carry load or do something else. In the Bible, Proverbs 16.32, it says, the second part of the proverb says, he that ruleth his spirit, than he taketh a city. The Lord has given us, and the explanation for this proverb, the Lord has given us our agency. And because the Lord has given us our agency, we are free to make our choices. And these choices determine our future. As we choose righteousness, the Bible says, we prove ourselves worthy to serve in the kingdom of God. To choose righteousness, we need to be trained. And we need to train our own mind and intellect. Now, why should a human being, why should a person go through such a laborious inward? I mean, I gave the example of a horse. I mean, why should I equate myself to a horse? But by the way, when you go to the army, it is the same thing. When you climb mountains, it's pretty much the same thing. So there are human, and when you want to become a federer, it is pretty much this. When you want to achieve the pinnacle of yoga, when you want to become a yoga ruda, you need to go through it. There is no other choice. But why should this laborious inward training, self-discipline, all that, what is, why? What does this person become through all of this? What is the glory of such an individual? For that, we'll go through both verses 8 and 9 together.
Jnana Vijnana Triptatma. Kutastho Vijitendriyaha.
Kutastho Vijitendriyaha.
Yukta Ityuchyate Yogi.
Yukta Ityuchyate Yogi.
Samaloshtashma Kanchanaha.
Samaloshtashma Kanchanaha.
Suhrin Mitraryudasina.
Suhrin Mrityaryudasina.
Madhyastadvesha Bandushu.
Madhyastadvesha Bandushu.
Sadushvapicha Papeshu.
Sadushvapicha Papeshu.
Samabuddhir Vishishyate.
Samabuddhir Vishishyate.
Jnana Vijnana Triptatma Kutastho Vijitendriyaha Yukta Ityuchyate Yogi Samaloshtashma Kanchanaha Suhrin Mitraryudasina Madhyastadvesha Bandushu Sadushvapicha Papeshu Samabuddhir Vishishyate.
So what does this individual gain? What is the glory of this individual? Triptatma. Triptatma means fully complete, fulfilled, satisfied, completely satisfied. With what? Jnana Vijnana, knowledge and wisdom. and thereby self-realization. Jnana here refers to textual knowledge, what you read in text. Shastra Jnana, the clarity that one gets by reading the scriptures. This is what we have seen earlier, Paroksha Jnana. Remember that Mount Everest example? I have not experienced Mount Everest. I have been told that it is the tallest mountain in the world. When I climb a mountain, I feel that mountain is the tallest. So, Paroksha Jnana. Vijnana is Vishesha Jnana, experiential wisdom. And that comes from what? That comes from being a practicing yoga ruda. Anytime you get experiential wisdom, when you know, when you say that, yes, I have, remember that electricity yoga example? You know, where you put a chair and what is electricity? I have not seen electricity. Okay, you want to see electricity? Put your finger into that, you know, bulb holder on the wall, switch on the bulb and you'll get that 220 volt jolt. Now you know what, now I know what electricity is. Can you describe it? So that vijnana, that vishesha jnana that comes through direct experience. To get direct experience, one must become a yoga ruda. We can all talk about the beautiful forehand shot that Federer hits. To hit that shot, one has to become Federer. To become Federer, you have to become a yoga ruda. That requires bhakti and bhakti or devotion in addition to being a yoga ruda. Aparoksha jnana. And such a person is what is kutastaha. Kutastaha means remains firm, remains unshaken, nishchala, anchored. Kuta means anvil. You know what an anvil is? Anvil is a flat rock, a stone, you know, on which you keep a metal like an axe and you hammer it to sharpen it. You hammer that metal, sparks fly. You beat it up nicely and the metal sharpens, the metal changes, but the stone, that anvil, that does not change. And you can sharpen millions of metals on that, countless number of metals on that. An anvil on which all these extremities, what extremities? Shita, Ushna, Sukha, Dukha, Mana, Apamana, all of these, they hammer themselves, but this person, she remains unshaken. That is Kutastha. And how is this person like that? How is he so? Vijitendriya, one who has conquered his senses. Such a person, Yukta Yogi Uchyate. Uchyate is said to be a Yukta Yogi, harmonized in yoga, a harmonized yogi, harmonized with her true nature, in harmony with her true nature. And for such a person who is in harmony with her true nature, loshta ashma kanchana are samaha. So Bhagavan gives three elements. Loshta means a clod of earth. Ashma means a stone or a rock. Kanchana means gold. All of these are the same, are equal, samaha. So when one is harmonized with his true nature, all of these appear the same, meaning one does not inflate one's value above the other. What have we human beings done? We have inflated the value of gold simply because we don't see gold. You know, you have to mine for it. And you know, it shines. Coal also you have to mine for, but it's not as valuable because this shines. You know, so we have inflated the value of gold and we have deflated the value of that clod of earth, which is Mother Earth. See how irony, what an irony this is. What sustains our weight? What carries us on this planet? We have deflated its value. And that gold, you know, we'll put it in locker and, you know, we'll shine it and all of that. We'll make jewelry out of it. God created equals. He didn't distinguish between gold and clod of earth or stone. Human beings made them unequal. Saturdays are auspicious. On Saturday, you don't do this. I don't eat meat. You don't eat onion. On Saturday. God didn't even make Saturdays. They're made by human beings. He just made day and night. Gold is valuable. Clod of earth is not. our planet needs many, 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 many countless of these Kutastha Triptatmas, the way it's going. Moreover, Bhagavan says in the context of people, Suhrin, this is verse number 9. Suhrit means a kind-hearted person. A kind-hearted person, what does that person do? Does good, helps, without any expectations, just because the individual has a kind heart. Mitra. Mitra is a friend also. Suhrin is also a friend. Does good. Mitra also does good. But helps and does good because of a shared connection. Ari. Ari is an enemy. Causes harm because of the nature of the person. The person himself is a wicked person. That's why it causes harm. Dveshya, a person who hates. This person causes harm, may not be a wicked person, but there is a sense of revenge. There is antagonism because of some reason. Udasina, an indifferent person, unconcerned, you know, doesn't care. Even when you have to do your swadharma, duty, Udasina, not even concerned to do your own duty. Does not take a stand. Madhyastha, a person who is a neutral person, takes the mid ground, takes a fair position. Bandhu, a relative. So all of these, Suhrin, Mitra, Udas, Ari Udasina, Madhyastha, Dveshya, Bandhushu. And then what? Sadhushu. In the sadhu, the noble people, Apicha, that is, and also Papeshu, in the ignoble, both in the sadhu and in the ignoble, this person excels, Vishishyate, with a balanced mind, Samabuddhihi. So this does not mean that this person, you know, interacts with all of them equally, okay, will have a party with all of these people together, or treats them all equally. It does not, all that excels in their presence. It's not about how this person interacts with these people, which means that this person, this Triptatma, does not let these people of various hue and cry, of these different nature, relatives and not relatives, friends and enemies, balanced and unbalanced, unconcerned and concerned, all of these people, they do not make any dent on the inner poise of this human being, of this Triptatma. The Triptatma will experience. Somebody has to do something for me. The person has not done. I experience the problem. But the if I am a Triptatma, the inner poise is not disturbed. Acceptance without expectation. This verse, when I was reading it the first time, reminded me, you know, much before I read Bhagavad Gita and all, or even, any scriptures, sitting in Anjanagiri tea plantation, I made an acronym for tea, T-E-A. T stands for truth, because you have to be able to see what is the truth. We can't cloud our own eyes. Then E stands for expectation. How much you can minimize expectation. And A stands for acceptance. So T stands for truth, expectation, acceptance. We all must sip the tea of balance somehow. So Bhagavan started chapter 6 in this manner. The chapter is about what? Dhyana. The chapter is about Atma Samyama. That is what we came here now. That is what the chapter is about. Atma Samyama. The equilibrium of the self, the harmony with the true nature, with your own true nature. That is Atma Samyama. That is what Bhagavan is going to teach now. But before he is going to teach, he has taught us about how we have to do Karma Yoga, become a Yoga Rudha, through being a Aru Ruksha, and then get to Atma Samyama. By what? Ourself. Using our own self to grow. From ignorance to Yoga Rudha, one traverses the path through Karma Yoga, is what Bhagavan taught us. From Yoga Rudha, how does this person become a Yukta? Yukta means harmony, harmonized. Through Yoga again. So from ignorance to Yoga Rudha through Yoga. What Yoga? Karma Yoga. From Yoga Rudha to Yukta, through what? Through Yoga again. What Yoga? Dhyana Yoga. Earlier, Yoga referred to Karma Yoga, Ishwararpana Buddhi and Prasada Buddhi. Now, Yoga refers to Dhyana Yoga, the Yoga of meditation. Yoga refers to Atma Samyama Yoga, the Yoga of harmonizing with the True Self. And to get here, the Muni sage, what does the sage, this Muni, this Yoga Rudha, what does this person renunciate? You have to renunciate Karma Yoga. You have to give up Karma Yoga. Sannyas is what? Sannyas is giving up the lower to attain the higher. So you give up Karma Yoga to attain Atma Samyama Yoga. So with a lot of preparation, you know, action, the rocket is put on the launch pad. Now it has to be released. Cannot hold on to it. Similarly, a sannyasi has to let go of Karma Yoga. Cannot hold on to it because, you know, I love Karma Yoga so much. So from the next verse, Bhagavan takes up this path that we have to traverse, that this Muni has to traverse, from Yoga Rudha to Yukta. From verse number 10 to verse number 32. That is what, about 23 verses. That is the Yoga of Meditation. We shall start in the next satsang. Thank you. Hari Om.
I'll now repeat the verses from the beginning.
Yes.
Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha. Atha Shashto Dhyayaha. Atma Samyama Yogaha. Shri Bhagavanu Vacha. Anashrita Karma Phalam. Karyam karma karoti yaha sasanyasi cha yogi cha naniragnir na chakriyaha yam sanyasamiti prahu yogam tam vitti pandava nahya sanyasta sankalpaha yogi bhavati kashchana arurukshor munir yogam Karma karana muchyati yoga rudasya tasyaiva shama karana muchyati yadahinindriyatishu karma svanu shachyati sarva sankalpa sanyasi yoga rudasta dochyati uddhari dhatmanatmanam natmanam avasadayit Atmaiva hyatmano banduhu, Atmaiva ripuratmanaha, Banduratmatmanastasya, Yenatmaivatmanajitaha, Anatmanastu shatrutvi, Vartitatmaiva shatruvat, Jitatmanatrashantasya, Paramatma samahitaha, Shitoshna sukha dukkeshu tata manapamanayoho jnana vijnana triptatma udasto vijitendriyaha yukta ityuchyate yogi samaloshtashma kanchanaha suhran mitraryudasina madhyastadvishya bandushu Sadushvapicha papishu samabuddhir vishishyate. Om asato ma sadgamaya tamaso ma jyotirgamaya mrityorma amritam gamaya Om purnamada purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. ओम शांति 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 हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम
थैंक यू हरि ओम एनी थॉट्स कमेंट्स What I was very invigorated with is how Bhagwan sets the platform for meditation. It's fantastic. And he's not even come to the platform. Now he'll come to how you sit in meditation.
I just have one thought which has come to my mind a lot of times when we talk about Ishwar Arpana Buddhi, doing everything with Ishwar Arpana Buddhi and Prasad Buddhi. Like you just said that for a yogi, the litmus test is like you completely get absorbed in what you are doing. So how do you remember that you are dedicating that work to the Lord? You actually forget that. You don't do everything thinking about that, you know. You are just doing because you are so dedicated and you are so absorbed in that you just go on. So if that thought is not coming to your mind of Ishwar, that I am doing this for with that thought of Ishwar Arpana Buddhi, is it okay? I mean, is it justified still? I mean, you can't think of that all the time when you're doing your work.
I would say it's absolutely, there's this beautiful story about footprints in the sand, you know. So this person asks, you know, Bhagwan, yes. I see your footprint along with me, but in the toughest moments, I don't see your footprint. Bhagwan says, those are my footprint. I was carrying you. So similarly, when you are not thinking about God, God is thinking about you. He's with you. So if you are so much into it, then Bhagwan manifests in that. He manifests in that activity itself. So you may not be thinking, but you know, Bhagwan is thinking at that time.
Yeah, I'm a very, very firm believer of this story. I feel it to the core.
Yeah, so if you are doing with Ishwara Arpana Buddhi and you have gone so deep that you have forgotten about Ishwara, that means he is with you. Any questions, thought, comments? Okay, then Hari Om, thank you very much. We will see you on next Saturday. Thank you.